It's Valentine's today, so I decided to do a relationship-centered video. So, the topic is how to have a perfect love, okay? A working love. It's a working love that's perfect, right? So, there's three stages to a working love. And any relationship that's working has this, and any relationship that's not working has faltered or failed on one of these steps, okay? So it's really important you understand and get clear of what happens on each stage and what you can do to improve each stage and take advantage of each stage and you know, how you need to work towards that perfect love. So this is going to take a little bit of time. I'm going to try to keep it short, but each of these steps is so important. I have to make sure I cover it well enough so you can, you know, do the steps successfully. Okay? So please do watch the whole video. I know some people don't like long videos, so come back. This is really, really important information today. Okay? So, the three stages are friendship, engagement, and embracement. And these three things happen the minute we start connecting with the person. The minute we meet someone, there's energy of friendship, there's energy of engagement, and there's energy of embracement. They're all happening at the same time. And those things happening create our attractions and repulsions with people. All right? And as we develop through these stages, our attractions and repulsions with people will change. So, if we don't manage to work through a stage, develop a stage healthily with the person, we'll find our attraction towards them starts to wane. However, if we develop a stage successfully with the person, we'll find our attraction towards them increases. And it should, because now you actually have something. Alright? But the minute you meet someone, all the attractions and repulsions you're experiencing are because of these three dynamics. Okay? Now, on my chart here, you'll see friendship has a short arrow with one head, engagement has a longer arrow with two heads, and embracement has the longest arrow with three heads. That's because the degree that these stages impact you. These are going to impact your emotional and energetic bodies. Which means, once they impact them, you're going to carry this with you. So, but they all will have an impact. It's just some things will impact you more greatly. And you don't want to get impacted into something and be impacted deeply by something that's not right for you, right? Because if you are, you're going to have a lot of hang-ups, a lot of possible traumas after it all goes to hell, okay? So to avoid that, what's really important is that even though all three of these dynamics are happening, the minute you're in the same space with somebody, that you successfully develop each phase before you go on to the next one. You're going to want to go on to the next one the minute you meet them. But if you do, you're probably going to screw everything up. Okay? You have to start at the beginning phase. Meaning you have to not start there. You're always engaged, involved in all three phases. But you have to develop the first phase successfully before you move on to the next phase. Got it? So I'm going to talk about what each phase is, or each stage, whatever you want to call it, each step. And then explain what it means to develop it and what you can do to improve the quality of that stage. Okay? Because on each of these stages, we all have our capacity to relate. Alright? If your capacity to relate on any of these stages is low, you cannot successfully complete that stage with a person. Which means you'll have to work on yourself a lot in order to complete that stage with anyone on earth. Got it? Okay. So, the first stage is a stage of friendship. Meaning that when you meet someone, or you have someone in your life, you like them. You like the person they are. You find them interesting. You find their ideas insightful and, you know, good ideas. You like the way they laugh at jokes. You like the things they laugh about. You just like them as a person. Okay? Now, what I've always said, it's easy to find love, but it's really, really hard to find friendship. It's hard to find someone you like. So I'd always say it's easy to find love, but it's hard to find someone you like. By love, I mean this desire to embrace someone. This is attraction that you want to get in there and get close and get bonded and connected and have sex with that person. That's cheap. You'll find that every day. You know, I could walk out and get 10 of those every day. Or not get them, but encounter them. They're all over. Okay? As humans, we're prone to that. But liking somebody, wow, finding someone you like, that's work. You know, that takes time. And that's the key word to this state, this first stage. Take your time. Okay? See if you like the person. Yeah, you're attracted to them because there's these three dynamics going on. But first develop the stage of, do I like this person? You know, just like the person they are. You know, when I hear them tell things about themselves or tell things about their idea, do I go, cool? Or do I go, what? Do my eyes roll, you know? And I'm like, oh my God, how do they say this, you know? You need to observe that and see if you like the person. While you're working that out, yes, you're going to have this energy to want to do things with them, which is the engagement energy. And you're going to have the energies to get deep into their space and have sex with them, which is the embracement energy. But if you jump into those things before you've really figured out if you like them, you're doing them prematurely. Okay? So you need to take time to see, do I even like this person? Okay? Do I like what they stand for? You know? Now, like, you know, when you're going to like some things about everyone, and you're going to not like some things about everyone. The key here is, do I mostly like this person? You know, which means I like most of what this person is about. And can I accept what I don't like? Because there's always going to be something you don't like. You're going to have to accept it. But can you, right? So this stage is successful with the person when you go, wow, I like that person. But these things I don't really, you know, buy, but I totally accept them in the person. I don't feel I need to change that about the person or argue with the person about them. I can accept them with being that way. It's okay. All right? You have to have both of those. When both people feel that way for each other, they smile at each other and they go, I like you, you know? And yeah, I can just be amused by these things and accept these things. Amused in a loving, caring way, not amused in a, you know, sarcastic way. The things I don't get about you or I can't relate to, you know, and accept those things. Now, to do that successfully, you have to accept yourself. If you don't accept yourself, you can't possibly accept the things about another person that you don't like. You just won't be able to do it, all right? So in this friendship stage, as you're developing the friendship and seeing, am I mostly feeling that I like this person? Are there many more things I like than the few things I dislike? Okay, and can I accept the things I dislike? Well, you can if you accept yourself. Because you too have problems and you have things you don't even like about yourself. But can you accept them? If you can, you'll be able to accept the things you don't like in your partner. Okay? Now, you want to like a lot of things about your partner, but you can't like a lot of things about your partner until you like everything about yourself. So, if there's some things you're struggling to like about your partner, you can like those things more if you start liking yourself more. Okay? So, every stage has a dynamic. There's the you dynamic and the with them dynamic. And the with them dynamic can only be as great as the you dynamic, the I dynamic. So, I like myself this much and I accept myself this much, and that means I can like and accept anyone else to that same degree. But if you're like, gosh, I really hate myself deep down inside and I don't accept myself in 101 different ways, well then when you meet someone, you're going to not be able to accept them in 101 different ways either. Okay, so this stage is important. Okay, it doesn't affect you the most deeply. At this stage, you can decide, I don't really like that person. You know, no big deal. You know, and you could just say, look, I think you're a great person, but I just don't think, you know, we have enough in common to continue trying to have a relationship, you know? And I'm glad we tried, no big deal. And you can just leave and don't feel anything. You know, it's just, all right, we didn't get past the first stage, no big deal, okay? If you get through the first stage and you go, wow, I like this person. You know, I went to their Facebook profile and I stalked them for half a day and, wow, I like these things they're posting, you know what I mean? Or I like that they post every 5 minutes, or I like that they post once every 2 months, you know? And you just, and you talk to them more importantly, of course, and you figure out, do you like the things they have to say? Do you like their thoughts on things? Do you like what's important to them? And then you find out if you like them. And if you like them, great. That was a hard thing to find. It's hard to find people we sincerely like, okay? Even though it doesn't impact us the most deeply, it's a hard thing to find, okay? If we're struggling with liking people in general, like we all know people who don't like anybody, right? Well, they need to learn to like themselves and accept themselves more, a lot more. And then they can start liking other people. Then they'll have a chance to build a relationship. But if you don't build this step successfully, you can't build a successful relationship with the person on a deeper level. Okay? All right. After you get through the friendship state, you go, yeah, I like that person and I accept what I don't like about the person. You have the engagement state. Now, the engagement state is a very powerful state. It's where you want to do things with that person. Okay? You want to engage with them. You're thinking about them, okay? You want to engage in them. And this can be a very powerful state, you know? There could be a lot of things you're just drawn to do with that person, you know? And as you find that there are certain things that you guys both just are important to both of you, and then you think, wow, we could do those together, you want to engage, okay? So, that engagement phase usually always gets involved with the friendship stage. So you're in the friendship stage trying to figure out if you like the person. But one of the ways you do that is by doing something with the person. And while you're doing something with the person, say you, oh, let's go to the museum. So you go to the museum, your engagement. You're engaging to go to the museum. You're doing something together now. Okay? And you go to the museum. And as you're driving to the museum, of course, you're talking about each other, you know? And you're sharing your stories, and you're still figuring out if you like them, okay? Now, ideally, you would know if you like them already, okay? But really, it doesn't usually work that way. And it's okay to begin engaging with someone as you're still figuring out if you, how much you like them, all right? However, it would be best if we could somehow figure out a way to figure out what we like, if we like a person before we really start doing things with them. Because that way it's not like awkward, well, you know, I know we've done a lot of things, you know, we went to every art gallery on the East Coast, yeah, and but now I've sort of decided I don't like you. It's like, how awkward is that? You know what I mean? So it's really better, before you really start doing things together, to really just spend time talking. You know, just spend time talking. Yes, you can go out to dinner and just talk. You can meet at a coffee shop and talk. And just find out if you like the person. And then if you like the person, say, hey, how about we go do this? But lots of times what tends to happen, it's not a big problem really, is that you start doing with things with people, which means you've sort of made it a commitment to like do things with them. And then along the way, you kind of go, you know, I don't really like you. You know, geez. So you want to do some homework first. You want to say, you want to at least get to the point of the friendship stage that, yeah, I think I like this person, you know, enough to do something with them, okay? But always figure that out first. Do you like the person enough to do something with them before you go into the engagement state? Because that's when you're doing something with people. And there's so many things we can do, okay? Now, there's three ways we can engage with a partner, okay? The best way is that we can feel together with that partner and engage on the things that are important to each partner, You're living for this, and I'm living for this. This is a nice thing that you love doing, and I love doing this too. And you do those things together as you're living yourselves. Okay, so you're being yourself, and then your energies come together and do things together. And it's a natural process. Okay, it's not a lot of discussion taking place. That's the most beautiful, natural type of engagement possible. It's very, very uncommon, though. The reason it's uncommon, because people struggle to be themselves enough to have that kind of embracement with their partners. Okay, and I'll talk about that more. A very common way couples engage, especially once they've gotten to know each other, is they keep track. You did this with me, and now you have to do this with me. Okay, so they're compromising. Yeah, I really don't want to go on the fishing trip, but since you took me dancing, I guess I have to, you know? And the guy's like, I really don't want to go dancing, but since, you know, I do want you to go fishing so you can cook up the fish, because I don't know how to cook fish good. You know, so it's this compromise. They're engaged, they're doing things together, but one person is compromising more often than ideal. How often should you compromise? Never. Who wants to compromise? I mean, come on. Love is not about compromise. Love is about appreciating what the other person is and joining your energies together when it's right. Okay? So, compromise relationships oftentimes get frustrating. Okay? The reason they happen is because people aren't being themselves enough. As a person learns to be themselves more and thrive as themselves more, and embrace their lives more, and embrace themselves more, they naturally start to go towards a more, a more enjoyable form of relationship, which is, you know, that, or the most enjoyable way to engage and do things with each other, is that you both take joy in what the other person does, and you take joy on the things you do together, because that's what each of you are, okay? So there's no you owe me, I owe you. It's like we are this, I'm this, you're this, and together we come together and just naturally do these things, okay? Now, between those two sort of extremes, there's a middle ground of a win-win relationship. Win-win means it means I like this and you like this, so we'll do those things together. We're going to plan on doing those things together, okay? We're a couple, so we have to do things together. But we're not going to compromise. I'm not going to make you go fishing and you won't make me go dancing. But we both love, you know, opera. So we will go to opera together. Okay? And that's a workable relationship. People are doing what they like together. But it's not the best relationship. Because the deepest engagement is when you're naturally engaging with yourself and at the same time that allows you to engage with your partner. And it's not planned. It's not like, okay, yeah, we're going to plan to do something together. But you're living your lives and your energy comes together, shares, does what it does. You're living your lives, your energies comes together, it shares, it comes together. You belong together because you keep coming together. But you have your own lives, you know? And you belong together. How do you know? Because you always end up coming together. And every time you do, it's wonderful and beautiful and joyous, right? It's not like you plan on being together. It just happens because you belong together. If things belong together, they're going to be together, right? And there's no ownership. There's no, oh, well, since you're my wife and it's the weekend, or since you're my husband and it's Friday night, we have to figure out what we want to do together. And okay, let's go through all the things we like doing and let's pick one of them. That's not the most ideal relationship, okay? That's the best relationship most people are capable of until they get to a really deep level of engaging their own lives, living their own lives, okay? So those are the three levels engagement can happen, but it has to happen powerfully. Either way, you need a powerful engagement, which means you need energy that says, I want to do something with that person, okay? Now, there's two facets to that. Facet one is you have to engage with yourself. Facet two is engaging with the partner, with the other person. See, you only can have something to the degree that you have it with yourself. So, some people are what we call engaging personalities. I mean, there are people that people want to do things with. They go, I want to do something with them, right? Think of all these famous actors and musicians. Why do we spend hours binge watching a TV show, right? Because there's the engaging characters, there's the engaging actor. You know, we want to engage with these people. So sometimes we want to engage with these people more than the people we know. And so people will spend all this time watching TV and engaging with fictional characters because they're more engaging than the people that people are surrounded by. Okay? So, to be successful at engaging, you have to be an engaging personality. And what does that mean? That means you engage with your life. You engage with yourself. Simple. You have a life, and you engage with it, and you live it, and you're thriving in it. The more you have a life that you're engaged in, that you thrive in, the greater of an engaging personality you become, and the more choices you'll have of who wants to engage with you. But if you're just sitting around on the couch, waiting for your life to start when Mr. Right shows up, then you're not an engaging personality. You know? You're not going to get offers of engagement. You just won't. You have to be an engaging person to engage. So if you're not getting enough engagement, well, how do you cure that? Engage more with yourself. Do with yourself what's you. Not some face thing, fake thing that you think you need to do. Engage with what you are. Engage with yourself and others will follow. Everything starts with yourself. If like and accept yourself more, others will like and accept you more. To accept yourself, to engage with yourself is step number one. That's the foundation of how much others can do with you. So, engagement is a point of great struggle between partners. It really, really is actually a difficult point. Engagement's a critical part of a relationship because that's where you're spending most of your time with the person. It's not the deepest. The deepest is the embracement, okay? It's the doing the things. What are you doing with the person? That's what takes up most of your time. And while you're doing that, you're enjoying your friendship with them. You're enjoying the person that you like. And you'll also be embracing them, which is the last stage. But time-wise, you're going to be engaging. So when a counselor says, you guys need to spend more time together, they're saying, you need to engage more. Okay? And the way to engage more with a person on earth is to engage more with yourself. Have a life that will allow you to engage with others. You only can engage with your full energy along the road of your life. You know, if this is what the road you're engaged in, you can't really engage on a road that's way the hell over there. You know? Because your energy won't be there. Your energy is your energy and it's driving you through life. And you need to engage with others whose life is joining to yours because of where their life is engaging them. Okay? Now, engagement, what does that mean? It means my mind's involved in it. My consciousness is engaged in it. I'm thinking about it. You know? So you decide to go on a walk with your partner. You both like walking, right? So you decide, okay, we're a partnership, so we both like going on hikes. So we're going to go on a hike, or we're going to go on a cruise, whatever, you know? But one person's consciousness is on, you know, this. Another person's consciousness on this the whole time. So even though they're going on a walk together or they're on the cruise together, they're not engaging. Because their consciousness, what their minds and consciousness and hearts are engaged in, is not the same thing. Okay, now, it doesn't have to be the same thing. Okay? I mean, it has to be the same thing, but it doesn't have to be their own thing. They could just be extremely engaged on each other. And that's really wonderful. That's a beautiful, beautiful engagement where your mind and heart are just engaged in them. You find them so engaging that you don't remember what your job is anymore. You know? You find them so engaging that you don't need your hobby anymore that you used to spend 100 hours a week engaged in. Okay, you can be engaged in a person. Why? Because you like them so much. You know, if you really like a person, you'll want to be engaged with them. You'll want to do things with them. You know? Okay. But you have to be an engaging person. You have to engage with yourself. Okay? You can't just sit there and think you can connect to people if you're not engaging yourself, if you're not living your life. You have to have engagement energy. You have to live as you are. Now, some people, unfortunately, have had a lot of trauma in their early lives that makes them lost about who they really are. And they can't engage with others. Why? Because you only can engage as yourself. You can't engage as a person that you think you're supposed to be. It won't work. You can go through the motions and you can do the things with the people, but you won't be engaged, which means you won't be connected there. And so it'll be meaningless. It won't touch you deeply, and it won't touch them deeply. So you have to be engaged with yourself. You have to be involved in what you are, you know? And then you have the energy to healthily engage with others through the things you both are inclined to engage with, and also due to the fact that you just like each other, so you want to engage with each other. Why do you do astrology? Why do you spend your time thinking about astrology? Because you really, really like it, and you find it really, really interesting, and doing so warms your heart. Good. Find a person that you like enough, that your consciousness is engaged with them, and that your consciousness is thinking about the things it wants to do with them, you know? So this is a really important, important stage. If you're lacking this stage, the first thing you have to do, the primary thing you have to do, is engage with yourself more. As you engage with yourself more, you'll have opportunities to engage with other people. Which other people? The people that are right for you. The person you think you want? Not necessarily. Maybe. Maybe not. The person who's right for you, which is the person you should want. Okay? So if you're struggling on this level, which is a common level of struggling between people, they're not engaging, they're not doing enough, when they do things, they're not connecting. Start with engaging your own life, and then see what engagements that brings. If it helps you engage with the person you think you're supposed to be with, great, you're supposed to be with them. But if instead you find yourself engaging less with them, fine. Engage less with them and engage more with your life and everyone that includes. Because we need to be engaged. We want to be engaged. Why do you think 4 million people watch a bad TV show? They need to be engaged more than they are. Okay? The more engaging the person, the less they watch TV. The more engaged a person, the less they watch TV or read great novels, etc. Okay? And the less they work even. You know, because when we're engaged with people, that's the most beautiful engagement we can have. Okay? So, engagement. Super important, important phase. Do you have the energy to come together and do things naturally? Not because you're supposed to, not because it's Christmas, because it's in your consciousness to do so, along with what's in your consciousness, and what your consciousness is engaged in is your life. And part of that life is engaging with that other person. Okay? Now, a lot of people, one of the things they just do is have sex. Okay? Sex is not part of the engagement. Okay? It doesn't fall into this step. It falls into step number 3, embracement. Why? Well, as you're going embracing each other, right? So, but for some of people, sex is just what they do with people that they're attracted to. You know, if they're attracted to them a lot, yeah, I think I gotta have sex with them, you know? And so they can be engaging to have sex. Doesn't work though. It'll cause problems because you don't want to embrace, which means form a deeper connection with someone until you're ready for the embracement state. Because the embracement state is where you affect people very deeply. Okay? That's where you affect people where you can leave scars or where you can mend scars. It's the deepest level of impact a person's going to have. And a lot of that dynamic, some of it happens on the level of sexuality. Okay? So, people shouldn't have sex until they're ready for the embracement stage, which means they've succeeded in the friendship stage and they say, I like you. And they've gotten to the point of, wow, our lives allow us and bring us together to do things. I'm engaged with my life. I'm engaged with myself. I'm an engaging personality, therefore. And you are too. And not only that, but wow, our lives are coming together naturally, spontaneously, and deeply engaging. Why? Because as we are being ourselves, we come together. Because we belong together. You're not mine, I'm not yours. You're you, I'm me, and we come together because we belong together. That's the ideal you want. It's not like, well, we're in a relationship, therefore you have to go do this with me on Christmas. Or, oh, it's Valentine's. Oh, yeah, you know. You have to do this with me because it's Valentine's. I got you by the balls, you know. No, none of that, you know. Or it's Friday night. We got to go out. No, none of that. You're being yourself. They're being themselves. And you engage and come together. That's what you want to work on. You want more quality engagement with your partner. Be yourself more. Okay, learn to be yourself more. And this is a lifelong struggle, learning to be yourself more. And as you become yourself, if you belong with your partner, you'll be with your partner. And when you engage, it'll be better than ever. There'll be nothing out of place when you engage. It'll be beautiful. So if you get through those stages, you like the person, and you find that as you are yourselves, you keep coming back to each other because you belong together. Great. Okay, then you've really got perfect love. If you got one of the other engagements that you want to engage with the person, but you have to like plan it, and you have to say, well, okay, I'll compromise today, but I owe you one because you know you did this for me last week, so I guess I'll go. You may not say that to your partner, but you're thinking that. You're like, well, you know, she did go fishing with me last weekend, so I guess I'll take her to that event she wants to go to. No. If you're working on that level, fine. But try to bring it up to the level of really, we're both thriving, you're thriving, I'm thriving, and we're connecting because it's natural for us to belong together. That's the best kind of love. And that you don't have to have that in the beginning. You won't have it in the beginning. Why? Because most of us are not thriving enough as ourselves to have that with someone right away. But you want to keep that as the goal. And while you're getting to that goal, work through the lower levels, the less joyous levels of engagement. You know, do work on compromise so you can learn to be with each other a little bit. But better yet, do just find the things that are important to both of you that you both want to do and plan to do those things together. But keep in mind, you want to become yourselves, a great dynamic energy on this earth of what you are that naturally comes together with the people that you belong with. Through magnetism, the magnetism of love, okay? So, once you've gotten to those levels, there's a point where you'll decide, I like this person enough, and I'm engaged in them. I think about them, I wonder about them, I look forward to doing things with them, I'm inspired, you know, to give them a present, you know, I just can't help myself, I need to engage with them and give them a present. You know, when they give me a present, it's so engaging. I'm like going, oh great, you gave me a present and now I gotta owe you a present for your birthday too. None of that. It's just, you actually are engaged, you know, and you're looking forward to seeing that person. You know, your energies want to come together and do something, okay? And your energies want to be together, okay? At that point, you're ready for the embracement state. Then you're ready to have sex. And do the rest of the embracement. Sex is just a little wee part, you know, no pun intended, a wee part of the embracement. It's a whole giant world, okay? But you have to get through these stages first, because in the embracement stage, that's when you're really holding on to somebody. You're stuck with the person once you get to the embracement stage. At that point, your body's energies has gotten knotted up together. And you're not just going to be able to say, oh, it was nice trying, see you later. It's going to be like trying to get out of there. You'll get wounded, you'll get damaged, or you will damage others if you're a heartless bastard, you know? It's an important stage. But imagine if you get to that stage where you're embraced with someone you didn't succeed on the friendship level with. So you're knotted, you're energetically and karmically knotted together now with someone you don't even like, you know? And here you are feeling attached and bonded with this person that half the things they say, you're going, what? Really? You think that? Oh my God, how did I marry that person, you know? Wow, do you want that? That's what happens when you don't develop the friendship state first. Nobody wants that. That's a shitty place to be. Those are the relationships that end. Those are the relationships after 2 years. After 6 months, you're sexually bonded because you started having sex within 2 weeks. You've embraced. You're karmically tied together now. I can look at his horoscope and predict what's going to happen to you now because you're karmically tied together, you know? And then 6 months later, you find out you don't like them and you don't even want to be with each other, and it takes you a year and a half to get out. So you just wasted 2 years of your life and reduced the chances of you finding a working relationship where you could have children or whatever it is that you want, right? So, you don't want to embrace until you like a person, okay? Not only that, you don't want to embrace until you see that, well, we seem to belong together. Because I'm living as me, as good as I can. They're living as them, as good as they can. And wow, we come together, you know? We come together. And sometimes it's a funny little thing. It'll just be like, oh yeah, when I'm free, they just happen to be free. And it happens all the time. It's like, you know, my boss said, okay, don't come in today. You can take the day off. And oh, what am I going to do? And then I get a call from her or him and they say, you know what? My boss said we already met the quota this week and we can take the rest of the week off. What are you doing? It's like, wow, how did that work? How did this opportunity just come to be together? You're flowing as yourselves and just life lets you be together. And it just can even get rid of obstacles. Like, it just moved walls. And wow, how did we end up together? We were just living our lives and boom, we came together. Okay? Are you coming together naturally? You know, if not, Why do you want to embrace and be tied to a person that you don't come together naturally to engage with? You know? Then you're nagging each other at that point. It's like, oh, you need to do more with me. Who wants that in your life? Well, nobody. But you get it if you start embracing a person and sleeping with a person, having sex with a person, before you even know if your lives can come together as your lives. Not pretending, not, oh, I'm going to just do anything to get this guy, or I'm going to do anything to get that girl. No, none of that. You're living as yourself. He's living as herself. You guys come together because you're living as yourselves. The only way you can come together in a deeply meaningful way. Okay? And you're living as yourself, and you're in each other's consciousness, and you're drawn to each other. Okay? Because you're coming from a point of yourself. You're not coming from the point of emptiness and neediness, and I need somebody to give me a life, and I need someone to help me pay my bills, and I need someone to fill this giant hole in my chart. No, it's not coming, it's not engagement from that point of view. Engagement from that point of view is gonna not work. It's engagement because I'm thriving as good as I can in myself, and I'm working on being more myself and thriving more as myself every day, and lo and behold, we are coming together. We want to come together. Our energy draws us together. And it makes our boss give us the same days off together, you know? But imagine if that doesn't happen. What if your energies are just like going far apart? When your mind's engaged in this, her mind's engaged in this. You know? And so you try to contact them and they're like, not even, they're going, And you're like, oh, why am I talking to this person? Oh yeah. Because I'm bonded to them. I'm karmically tied to them because we had sex 3 months ago. And then it takes a year and a half to get out of it. And it's not the relationship you wanted. So the general rule is, don't have sex. Don't embrace for 6 months. Because you might end up getting stuck to something that's not right for you. And it could take, on average, it takes a year and a half to get out of it. And so 2 years of your life just went down the tubes, other than you learned something. Well, I'm teaching you now in 1 hour, so you don't have to learn it in 2 years, okay? All right. The embracement state. That's a very, very deep state. This is where we're embracing. Now, I want you to imagine this. You can be embraced by a wonderful person, or you can be embraced by a grizzly bear. You know, what do you want, right? If a grizzly bear embraces you, you're just going to be crushed. Your spine's going to shatter. You're going to be dead. A lot of people get into that kind of relationship. See, in the embracement stage, something really interesting happens. There's a reason the minute you have sex with someone, your relationship changes. Okay? Because while you're going about, when you meet someone, you start seeing what you like about them. Your energies are saying, are we friends? Do we like each other? And your energies are going, can we do things together, the engagement state? Can we be engaged with each other? You know, can we think about each other and want to do things with each other? And do we just come together? You know? And then at the embracement stage, and again, this is happening the minute you meet someone, your energies are going, okay, am I going to heal the other person? Or am I going to hurt the other person? It is. Your energies are actually working out. Am I going to abuse them or heal them? Are you going to have the embrace of love or the grizzly bear embrace, right? Okay, that breaks you and leaves you with broken noses and bruises around your eyes or verbal abuse or any of that stuff that you don't want. All right, this is the most important stage. This is the stage that not only makes or breaks a relationship, it can make or break you. Okay? If you have this stage right with the person, you'll never want to leave that person. Okay? Because you'll be deeply connected to that person. So deeply, you know? So this, you want to hit this state right. And this is the hardest state to hit right. Okay? It's hard to hit. So how does this state work? The minute you get into a space with someone, your subconsciousness is analyzing all their body motions, all their body language, all their facial expressions, all their tone of voices. And you have a history in your body, in your cells, in your subconsciousness, of what all those signals mean to you. Okay? Because when you grew up as a child, you developed a history. Your elders, namely your parents, but anyone who you looked up to as, wow, that person's important. That person is God or an aspect of God. Parents are God when you're a kid, right? The only person you need to please as a kid is your parents. So we have these authorities that impact us because of our bond to them. Through our dependence to them. Okay? And these authorities, our parents particularly, but we also have other authorities that raise us when we're unable to do so ourselves. And they're doing their best, but they're not perfect people. So they're going to wound you, they're going to hurt you, they're going to neglect you, but they're also going to support you and they're going to encourage you too. And when they're doing those things, they're going to have a different body language, a different tone of voice, a different way they look at you, a different curve to their lip, right? And when you see those in other people, you're going to respond the same way you responded as a kid. Your subconscious is programmed to respond a certain way. So, let's say your parents said something to you, that when they said it, you got so angry, you know? They just wanted to say, fuck you. this is what I'm doing, you know? And you're just this little kid who's getting so angry, throwing a tantrum, or running around the room now, you know, because you just, but you can't, because you know, if you leave, and you're five, you're gonna die. So you hold that anger in, but there's anger, right? And then you meet someone, and then they use that same tone and voice of you. Wow, that's like a hypnotist on stage. It says, I'm gonna hypnotize you, okay? And so they, you know, they get their watch out, they hypnotize you, and then they say, when I blow this whistle, you're gonna jump up and down three times and stick your head in the toilet. And then they go, when I snap my fingers, you will not remember anything that I just said until I blow the whistle. And the hypnotist snaps his finger, and the guy says, what? Did you? When are you going to do it? And they go, oh, we already did it. And the guy says, no, you didn't even do anything. And the hypnotist says, you're right. Pulls out the whistle, blows it, the guy jumps up three times and then goes to the bathroom, sticks his head in the toilet, right? That's what happens to us when we get these cues. We literally go back to the state that's determined by our subconsciousness. And so a guy who wants to love and cherish a woman goes to a state of being a really frustrated four-year-old that's in an unhealthy situation. And so instead of doing what his adult self wants to do, to love and cherish that girl, he gets angry and explodes all over her and abuses her. Okay? So, we have these backgrounds that have impacted our subconsciousness. And as a result, these things get triggered. They come up in our consciousness and make it very difficult for us to behave the way we want to. And they come up with the people we're most attached to, which is our parents growing up, and then the person we choose to embrace as adults. So that person you're married to, or want to be married to, you know, that number one person in your life that you're embracing, that's the person that can make you as helpless, make you feel as worthless and useless and stupid as your parents did, and angry and frustrated as your parents did. Nobody else can, but they can, okay? Because of your subconscious memories. But you also you have these subconscious memories of feeling proud about yourself and feeling good about yourself and feeling capable and competent. And when your parents give you that, or the school teacher gave you that, or the neighbor next door gave you that, they also had a body language, a tone of voice, a way of being, an expression on their face. And your partner will trigger you with those things too. So once you get embraced, how your partner treats you triggers your past histories, meaning the history that's in your cells, in your chakras, of joy, love, and abuse, and helplessness, and hopelessness that you experienced as a kid when you didn't have a brain that could figure things out. Okay? So, at that point of it being embraced, once you're bonded to the person, which happens most specifically when you have sex, especially if you're female, okay, then this is a large part of your relationship, is you're going to be triggering the other person's history. Their what's that? The history of their life's experiences, the joys and sorrows, the pains, the sufferings, the hopelessness, the despair, the happiness, the joy. You can trigger those in that person based on how you treat the person, how you look at the person, at the tone of voice of the person you use. Okay? And that's why once people have sex, their relationship changes. And it's so much harder to get along. Okay? Especially if they don't even like the person, especially if they don't engage enough to feel loved by the person, but they're still bonded to the person. So, what the other person is doing is impacting them on a very, very deep, deep level. So, people have to be with somebody that brings out and helps them work with their past pains and joys in a constructive way that allows for health to flourish, allows them to be healthier, You know? Someone knows the person who instinctively embraces them in a way that makes that inner child that feels hopeless and unable feel competent all of a sudden. Versus the partner who says, well, all you have to do is, which in the exact same tone that their daddy said it to them. And so now all of a sudden the person feels more sad, more hopeless. Okay? So I want to explain this all again. It's so important. So imagine, you grew up and you suffered, and you grew up and, you know, each of you, one person here, one person here. You grew up and you had your joys. And there's a memory in your subconsciousness of all these experiences. And some of these were very difficult experiences. Experiences where you felt hopeless and afraid and angry and scared. And you weren't getting love. You didn't get the form of love you needed or care you needed at that moment. And there was a deep scar in there. There was a deep wound there now. Okay? And as you go and encounter with this person who's so important to you, your new demigod, your spouse or your lover that you've decided to embrace with your complete emotional body, what they do is going to trigger that stuff. It just will. Okay? Meaning you're going to come home sometime and you're going to feel despondent. Say you had a shitty day at work and you come home and you're depressed about work, right? At that moment, your partner can embrace you in one or two ways. They can embrace you in a way that makes you feel competent and able and makes you feel like everything's going to be okay. Or they can embrace you in a way that makes you feel more hopeless, more stupid, more foolish, more of a reject, whatever. If they are able to embrace you in a way that makes you feel better, then you can heal together. You can cry together and heal together. But if they embrace you in a way that pushes a button in you that makes you feel more hopeless, more frustrated, more despondent, more scared, then you're not going to be able to heal together. You're going to harm each other. Okay? So why do people hurt each other? Everyone who gets together wants to make the other person happy. They really do. The biggest asshole you dated, when he asked you to marry him, he was thinking, I'm going to make this girl happy, you know? But then he didn't. He broke both her legs, you know? Why? Well, because as they were embracing, his subconsciousness got triggered. The trauma in his subconsciousness got triggered. So instead of the woman being with an adult male, all of a sudden she's trying to have a relationship with a helpless feeling or angry four-year-old. And that angry four-year-old ruins everything. And the same thing will happen to the woman. The guy goes, I'm here to love and cherish you. That's why I asked you to marry me. And the woman's like, I'm here to make your life joyous. But something happens where she gets triggered into a state of nobody loves me, I'm not good enough, and she starts freaking out. And when she freaks out, how does the guy freak out more? And all of a sudden, this is playing off each other, and then people feel like they totally don't belong to each other. They don't even know what to say to each other. They're both in absolute pain, and they're not healing. So when those things start happening, it's critical, critical, critical that a person is able to step out of their wound, step out of their pain, step out of being controlled by their hurt, despondent, despairing, hopeless, and angry feeling inner child, and act like an adult, and offer love to their partner. When people can do that to each other, then they're having the most beautiful and deepest relationship. And it's very, 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 very hard to have that because people are so wounded. You know, think about the people you know who are hurt. How nurturing are they still able to be to the people in their lives? And you'll find there's a correlation between how much someone's been hurt, especially as a child, and their ability to nurture another living being. Okay? So, if a person has a history of being hurt, their ability to nourish another being is much, much less. But they're just as deep as a need to do so. Okay? And people of equivalent hurt attract each other. So if you get two deeply hurt people with a lot of trauma from that childhood pain, trauma that can be triggered with the wrong word, the wrong look, the wrong joke, you know? And they come together, then they're going to wound each other a lot. But if you get a person who's been wounded, like we all have, but they can still step away from that wound to be a caring adult, then they can nourish each other through those moments and form a deeply beautiful relationship. Okay? Now, to do that depends on so much on the individual people. You have to be able to heal yourself first before you can heal with them, to heal with your partner. Okay? So to heal yourself means you need to heal your wound. Okay? You have pain inside of you that you explore the entire world with. It's like that joke, you know? The girl goes to the doctor and she says, I have a broken finger. And, no, forget that. The girl goes to the doctor and she's a blonde. And she goes, I have pain. And the doctor goes, where? She goes, well, it's here, it's here, it's here, it's here, it's there, it's also here, and it's also here, and it's also here. And the doctor goes, well, you have a broken finger. Okay, see, if you have a broken finger, any part of your body you touch hurts. Okay? If you have a broken heart, every part of everything your heart touches makes you hurt. Okay? If you have a wound, everything you touch with that wound will hurt. And some people are so wounded, they literally walk out like, everywhere they walk, they have that broken finger in front of them. They walk and they hit this wall and it hurts. And they walk and they hit that person and it hurts. And this person hurts. They're in a constant state of being hurt because their wound is so huge. And so they can never embrace anyone on a healthy level because they're always too hurt to do so. So our wound, the degree of our wounds determine our ability to embrace another person. And embracing is the biggest area of a relationship, making it or breaking it. Of being something in your life that healed you and made your life better, or hurt you and destroyed your life. The other parts, the friendship part, the engagement part, those are wonderful things to share and experience. But even engagement will not make or break your life. It can add an immense value to your life. But embracement can make or break your life. If you embrace with someone who cannot embrace with love, it can ruin your life. And if you're the kind of person who cannot embrace with love, you will destroy the people you want to love. Okay? So, if you're finding in your relationships that you can't embrace or be embraced, because see, when you're wounded, you also can't be embraced, you know? If you have a broken finger, and then you're going like this with the broken finger, and someone gives you a hug, it hits your finger and it hurts. And you're like, ah, get away from me. See, when you're wounded, it hurts to be embraced, and it hurts to embrace, okay? So, if you've had problems where you haven't been able to feel loved, to feel embraced, honestly, it just might hurt too much that you'd rather not at the end of the day. Or if you're not able to embrace, it's because you're too hurt to embrace another person in their time of need. Then you need to focus on healing your wounds. As you heal your wounds, you can be a loving embrace for your partner. And so people will heal their wounds together usually, if they want to. But see, a lot of people don't realize that's what's happening in the embracement state, is that their wounds are getting in the way of them truly being deeply connected. And instead, they're triggering each other's wounds. And how do you know they triggered their wounds? Because they just ended up hurting each other. deeply hurting each other. They feel hopeless with each other. One person or the other feels hopeless, feels despair, feels angry. You know, all these emotions that all leave us feeling powerless. Our wounds always end up in that. You know, it's when you get to the point in your relationship where you feel you're absolutely unlovable, or that there's nothing you can do to make your relationship work. Just absolute helplessness. The helplessness of a four-year-old who would have to go out into the world and survive alone. We get put in that same place by our love partner, into the place of our four-year-old. So we have to heal those wounds that started in our early life, that started at birth. If we're going to be in an embracing relationship that allows the two people's pains to come together and work together and heal together. Okay? Love is healing, right? Being together is not healing. Love is healing. Love is the ability to step away from our pain, to embrace someone else on this level. That's really what it is. And the minute you start embracing someone deeply, which happens during sex, then this is the game you just started to play. And if while you're playing this game, you haven't worked out if you even like them, or you haven't even figured out how to do things with them, or you guys both feel good about what you're doing together, and now all of a sudden you're dealing with all your subconscious pain and trouble, but you don't even have the foundation of feeling love because you're not engaged. You don't even have the feeling of love because you don't like the person. And now you're trying to find healing with the person that you don't engage with, that you don't like. It's never going to happen. It will never happen. You will only destroy each other further. So you have to nail down the friendship and the engagement before you have sex. You just have to. Otherwise, you're going to be embracing someone, open up this can of worms without even having a foundation of being together. See, when you have the foundation of you like each other, let's think what happens then. So when you say something and the person, your partner, likes you, the expression on your face says, I like that. And that awakens the pleasant subconscious memories of their history of when an authority figure gave that same expression of, I like you. But if you don't like that person, and they're telling you things, and the expression on your face is like, then they're going to feel just as useless once you're embraced. They're going to feel just as useless as when they were trying to tell their daddy what they were going to do when they grew up, and dad was like, you know? So you have to like the person so that when it comes to the embracement state, you're ready to embrace them. And they have to like you, so they're ready to embrace you. Otherwise, those little signs, those little gestures, those little bits of, oh, yeah, I'm not really paying attention because I don't like that part about you and I don't accept it either, especially the don't accept part, can trigger a person into a negative subconscious memory. And then all of a sudden, your partner is a four-year-old feeling hopelessness, despair, fear, frustration, instead of an adult feeling love. This is literally what happens. This is how your relationships get sabotaged from within. Okay? Now, so that's why it's so important to get this friendship stage knocked down. Otherwise, your partner and you are going to trigger each other all the time. Trigger each other's negative subconscious memories. Then you've got your engagement. If you're engaging and you feel like you belong, wow, does that create the foundation to be together? But if you're not engaging and he's always doing this or she's always doing that and you're feeling alone all the time, well then yeah, your worst subconscious memories are going to be triggered out of that loneliness because you're not connected, you're not engaging, you're not doing together, you're not thinking about each other. You're being treated the same way you're treated by your dad who never looked at you, you know, who didn't do things with you. And so again, you're getting triggered. Your worst memories, your ugly memories are getting triggered. And so you become an ugly person. You can't be there for your person either If you're living out a memory, a feeling of hopelessness, pain, of when you were a four-year-old because of how they triggered, feeling neglected because you're not engaging, it's going to be hard enough if you have a neglection wound to not feel neglected if you are engaging. But if you're not engaging, there's no way in hell you're going to be able to feel anything but that neglection wound 24/7. And then out of feeling that wound, you're going to hurt your partner. Okay, so you can see the importance. Get these two steps right before you go into that deeply subconscious world with that person of embracement. Okay, it's a whole different level. The friendship level is very much an intellectual level. It's very much a level of mind. I like that. Tell me about what you like. I like that thing. I like this about you. You know, it very much is a up here level. Okay, the engagement levels are very much in here level. Of, I want to connect with you. I'm engaged by you. You're engaging to me. You know, I want us to bring together and connect. Okay, that's that level. All right, of connection, and they're all levels of connection. The embracement level. This is where your subconsciousness come together deeply. This is where you're getting deep and sticky with the person. And all that gets cemented when you have sex. So, don't go there. Because if you go there, before you have the friendship and engagement on a solid foundation of acceptance for the friendship, and the foundation of your lives are, you feel like you belong together, and that's happy because you find yourself wanting to do things with each other, then you're ready to go that next potentially destructive or potentially most healing step. Okay? And you want it to be the healing step because there's no option in this step. It's going to heal you or put you into a deeper state of disease. And if you don't have the first two steps worked out, there's only one place it can put you, and that's into a state of deeper disease. All right? As you work on that last step, the embracement step, remember, the best thing you can do for your partner in that step is not try to heal them. You can't heal someone else. It's to heal yourself. And in healing your own wound, you give them the room and the compassion and the acceptance and the love to heal their own wound. Okay? But you can't just go up to someone and say, you have to fix this about yourself. You're a wounded creature. You have to do this. Because when you start telling a person about their wound, you're poking it. And that don't feel good. And you can push people right out of your life. This is so easy for us to do. Us astrologers, we're the worst. That's why you never want to, you know, don't embrace a counselor. Because counselors, we're so good at looking at those wounds and poking on them. Okay? So, that's why, you know, psychologists have horrible marriages, right? Because they don't know how to just embrace with love. They're always going, yes, this needs to be done, this needs to be done, and this needs to be done, and you can do this. And then their partner's like, I don't feel love. They need just love. And the only way you can give a person more love is if you heal your own wound more. Okay? All right. There's a great book. I'm going to put it below in the thing. It's a book called The Mind... what is it called? The Mind-Body Connection. I'm kind of at it right now, so I'm not sure if I'm memorizing the title exactly. Okay, but I'll write it down. And this book talks about how to heal these wounds. And it also talks about some of the stuff I talked about today. But it talks about things you can do to heal your wounds and feel more able and more competent with your wounds. Okay? Because what happens is, these wounds are not just in our brain. They're literally in our bodies. And so, if we try to fix something in our bodies with our mind, it won't work. So you can understand your wound, scientifically speaking, perfectly. But until you can get your body to accept and heal that wound, you're still a wounded creature. It's not how much you know. It's how much your body and subconscious process that determine your ability to heal your wound. And this book has these really simple little exercises that help you work with the mind-body connection to help you get in touch with those wounds in a healthy way and heal them. And through that, be a better partner. A partner who can love instead of wound. Okay? That's the most important thing at the end of the day. In fact, when we look at an astrology chart for compatibility, the first thing we look at is is this person, how wounded is the person? Is the person so wounded that they will never be able to put their pain away to embrace anyone else? And there are some people that are that wounded. They just need a puppy dog this lifetime. That's the best they're going to be able to do, you know? But most people can heal their wounds with another person if you do go about it in a way that works. Sorry, the modern way of, wow, I'm attracted to you. Oh, I like one thing about you and I don't like those other 10 things, but I really love your tits, so let's have sex, doesn't work. It's not going to work. Work out the friendship. Make sure you got it. Engagement. Okay, now the astrology part. This is going to be quick. Astrology can help us on all three of these levels. Okay? It can help us with the friendship part by helping us accept and love ourselves more and like ourselves more. Getting a good astrology reading can help you accept yourself and like yourself more. So now you can accept and like others more. I'll tell you, my biggest, most important experience in astrology happened right when I started it. I was a very austere little bastard when I was growing up, you know. And I didn't have any empathy or compassion for anyone. You know, I was very judgmental, you know. I was like, you know, you didn't want to know me when I was 18 years old, you know. And, you know, and then I started learning these things and I learned to read the chart. And at the time I was doing Western astrology and all the Western aspects would come together in the chart. And it got to where I would look at that chart and all those Western aspects would create this feeling to me of that person. Of really what that person felt inside of themselves, you know. And I would look at a chart and I would just feel so much for that person. And it taught me to have empathy. Somehow I couldn't just have empathy looking at a person, you know. But when I looked at the chart, I realized that people, wow, what they are, what they feel. And so after that, I started having empathy for everyone. Shortly after that, I went to the grocery store. There was this 40-some-year-old frumpy dude sitting there. And it was all I could do not to cry as I was checking out the grocery store. I mean, it had so much empathy for all I could. I understood this guy's pain. And only astrology let me get to the point where I could just appreciate a person that way. So, astrology can really help us in lots of ways. That's the embrace way, right? I'm talking the friendship way, okay? As you get a good reading, as you learn astrology especially, it'll help you accept other people, okay? All right. That's important, but that's mostly about you. Okay, I like myself more because I understand my chart. I accept myself more, therefore I can like and accept others more. I like this person more, I accept them more because I understand what's going on behind the scenes, what's going on in their horoscope. Okay? All right. Then on the engagement level, astrology can be a big help because there's a big reason. There's a simple but hugely important reason you might not be getting enough engagement with your partners. And that is because you're not engaging as yourself. You can't engage with somebody if you're not engaging as yourself. No matter how many things you do with them, if you're not doing them as yourself, you are not engaging. You're just there. Okay? You're like a ventriloquist dummy. You're just along for the ride, but you're not getting any experience out of it. So, astrology can help us see where we block our way of being. See, our way of being is this powerful force of fire that wants to thrive on this earth. Our soul came down here to thrive, and it's a fiery thing, our soul, okay? It's like the sun. You want to know what your soul looks like? Just stare at the sun, okay? And then look at your life and see, is that coming through you? If not, you're not engaging fully with yourself. Okay, why? Because you have a block. There is a time throughout your life, many, many times, where you have a choice to thrive as yourself or to not. And there's a planet in your chart that is, when it comes to that choice, says not. I won't because of this. Because of just a bad habit. If you're not thriving as yourself, it's because you're in the bad habit of not thriving with yourself. And through astrology, through the Lajitadi Avashtas, we can see where that big roadblock is. Soon I'll be starting a course using the Lajitadi Avashtas specifically for that. Okay? Specifically to help you remove the blocks, the habitual blocks, that keep you from thriving as yourself. See, when you thrive as yourself, you attract the right job, the right prosperity, and the right person. If you're not thriving as yourself, you don't attract any of those right things, and you want to kill yourself. Okay? All right. So, it can help us engage. It can also help us see the engagement potential between two people through compatibility. Okay? See, compatibility is not we have things in common. It is our energies coming together. You know, if your energy is on that side of the world and my energy is on that side of the world, do they somehow find each other and bring us together physically? That's really what compatibility is. Okay? There's our energies pull towards each other so we belong together. Our energies not pulling to each other so we don't belong together. So compatibility can help us to see that on an intellectual level of, okay, are your guys' energy powerfully pulling together and in which way or not? Okay? But you don't need astrology for that. Because you can just through some experience with the person figure that out. But you certainly need astrology to help overcome the blocks that keep you from engaging with yourself fully and thriving with yourself fully, which is the number one roadblock to your not having the right partner. Okay? In the embracement, you bet, astrology can help in this dramatically as far as healing yourself. If you can heal yourself, you'll be able to embrace your partner with love instead of giving them some kind of twisted grizzly bear embrace that hurts them. Okay? So, embracing with love happens as you heal. And you heal as you get in touch with your wounds. Okay? Lajitadi Avashtas can also be used to identify and help us heal our wounds. So I'm also, in the near future, I'll be teaching a course on how to use the Lajitadi Avashtas for specifically handling your wounds. Okay? And of course, if you understand the wounds of your partner, you'll be able to embrace them more readily. So the thing that happens with intellectual people, which are really the worst kind of people to get involved with, you know, heart-centered people are the people to get involved with, you know? But you just might have the bad luck to have to hook up with an intellectual. Intellectuals need to know something in their head right before they have any hope of letting themselves do it right. It's not they don't have the capacity to do it right. It's just they don't know it's the right thing to do until they get the intellectual permission, okay? So unless they're an intellectual who has developed a sense of humor about the limitations of their intellect, an intellectual person can really benefit so much from a reading, a wound reading, about their partner. And when they intellectually understand their partner's wounds, they'll be able to be there for them in the right, loving, accepting way. You know, like one person I did, you know, the first thing they did, they brought their chart, and, you know, and I just said a few things. I said, okay, they've got this wound, basically. You know, they had a Saturn-Moon conjunction in the fourth house. Okay, that's a serious wound. And I just said this, and they said, oh, okay. And they married them. They've been together over 20 years of marriage, and they're actually a happy couple, believe it or not. Okay, they're engaged. They do things together. They have some engaging compatibility. They're a good couple. And she told me years later, she goes, the times when I just wanted to kill him, you know, I don't know if that's what she said, but the times she just wanted to shake her head and just was going crazy because of him, she just remembered where he was coming from, the wounded perspective he was coming from. And because she remembered that, she was able to accept him instead of judge him. Okay? So, if we understand our other partner's wounds, we can create the space for their wounds to heal. So you can't heal a wound. You only can provide the space for a wound to be healed in your embrace. But you can, sadly, hurt a wound, deepen a wound, you know, make the person feel more hopeless if you don't give them the space, which means in your embrace you squeeze the life out of them, okay? All the horrible things we see about people, anger, jealousy, possessiveness, you know, hopelessness, despair, depression, all these ugly emotions come out of our wounds. And astrology can help us sort these things out, okay? All right, so I think that's enough. The most important thing I need to stress is that if you just do these steps in the order that they work in, instead of jumping ahead, that alone can solve 75% of your problems. It really, really can. If you don't engage with someone that you don't like, and you most certainly don't embrace someone you don't like, the chances of you being triggered by a person once you're embraced dramatically diminish. Okay? If you decide to embrace someone because you know you're engaging, and there's a feeling of belongingness that's natural and not possessive, okay, and you're in each other's consciousness and you want to do things together and your energy allows for you guys to come together, if you have that person, then they will not push your damaging buttons as much as the person you don't have that with. Because what's the first thing that's going to happen when the person goes, or like one person, this is a sad story. This woman had a Saturn in the fourth house with the moon in the first, which is a really difficult, wounded combination. So, she gets married, they have their honeymoon, the first weekend of marriage, the guy goes, "Hi, good morning, hon. I'm going fishing. What are you doing?" And he leaves. You know, first weekend that they're married together, in their new place together, and he doesn't even want to engage with her, you know? Wow. And so how do you think that abandonment wound, that Saturn in the fourth with the moon in the first, is going to respond? It's going to respond of, "I'm absolutely unloved," you know? Now, if they had more engagement, healthier engagement, his consciousness would have wanted to do something with her. He wouldn't have had to force it. He wouldn't have had to force not doing something on her. And she was brokenhearted on the first Saturday following her wedding. Okay? That wound was triggered powerfully. So, it's really important that the engagement's there. Because if your partner doesn't want to engage, all your wounds are going to get triggered. You know? And engagement, healthy engagement, can only happen naturally. Compromising and going along for the ride when you really don't want to be there will not create a quality feeling of engagement. That's like, oh good, I don't have to go there alone. That's not like, you're not together. Okay? Doing things on the second level of possible engagement of just, alright, we both like doing this, so we'll do this together. And I wish there was more of this, but at least we have this. Okay, that's kind of better. But best is, we belong together because we're living as ourselves and we keep finding ourselves together. You know, I saw this interview once on People, about people on a TV show. And these people went around and interviewed people who had marriages of 50 years or more and who still were glad they were married. Okay, so they found some old timers, 80, 90 year old people, you know, some really old people. And they asked them, how did you manage to do this? And one couple said, this is the one I remember, because this was the most outrageous. I just really loved it. They said, we never decided to be with each other for more than 2 months. Every 2 months we got together and we said, do we still want to do things together? Do you want to do something in the next 2 months? And if the answer was yes, they stayed married. But they said if we'd said no, we would have got divorced. So every 2 months they revisited, do we want to engage? And every 2 months, their energy came together and said, yes, I want to engage with you for over 50 years. Okay? Another interesting example, a more, you know, a famous example is Goldie Hawn and her husband's name. Gosh, what's his name? Maybe I'll remember in a minute. Goldie Hawn and her husband. Okay? You know, they've been together 35 years or more. They never got married. They didn't need to own each other and have a title to each other. They never got married. They have their own rooms with their own things in their house. They have their own rooms, which is a really healthy sign to have your own rooms, but still find yourself coming together all the time. All right? So they've been together a long time because their energy chooses to push them together. Not push them, but to pull them together. The energy chooses that path. They're living their lives, each of them, and their energies pull them together because they belong together. It's not a question of your mind because you promised, and it's not a question of you signed the contract and you're scared to get divorced. It's because their energy says, yeah, we belong. We could just walk out of this, but we don't because our energy says, no, we belong together. And that's the beautiful part of engagement that you want to strive for. And you can increase the quality of your engagement. And that book I mentioned, that I'll put the name down in the author below, that book has techniques to increase the quality of your engagement with your partner as well. Okay? So nothing's hopeless. You just want to be true to yourself and heal. So, and then you can heal with your partner. Okay? And then whatever is best always happens. Okay? Alright, so I hope that this helps everyone here have better and better Valentines every year as you go through, and that everyone eventually finds a Valentine that comes naturally. A person that you're with, that it's not about it's Valentine's, what do you want to do? It's like Valentine's is happening naturally between us again, year after year. That's what we want. Okay, thank you.